Interactive session, day 5 of the certification in spinal manual therapy, where the day 5 we saw the two distinct patterns of symptomatology, midline symptoms versus unilateral symptoms, and progressing right from instabilities, which is anteroposterior or lateral, to stenosis, and as a combination of degeneration or disc prolapse, which might be into cauda equina, which is central symptoms, whereas radicular or the referred pain from the facet joint, which is in unilateral symptoms. So we have seen a combination of techniques, the probability of progression day-wise, and to individualize the therapeutic prescriptions on this day. So opening this session for the questions, for those who have directly attended on the Zoom from the morning till now. So Dr. Ritu is with us. So madam, go ahead with your questions.
Yes, sir. My first question is, sometimes some patients with disc bulge, they say they don't feel any pain in walking, not in running, even not in running, lifting weight, but they start pain, maybe it's a muscular pain that they feel a pinching pain in the facet area of, they don't know where is the facet joint. They tell that this is the place where the facet joint, they feel a severe pain. After that, they are not able to come in a flexion position and not in a extension position. But after sometimes they take some hot pack and cold pack, after that they feel normal. But they always complain that this pain comes, sudden it pains comes and it goes out. So what is the main cause of this pain?
The clinical picture itself, when you have sudden, you should think, okay? When I was telling today morning also, sudden means facet joint locks, sudden means a spasm, okay? So these two are the clinical picture there, okay? So it can come as a facet joint lock if there was a previous instability, clicking sounds were coming and going in the low back for a longer time. Otherwise, lock because of a degeneration, okay? Which was asymptomatic, it can go for lock anytime. Spasm, of course, can come anytime. You cannot tell in whom, for which activity the spasm comes. It depends on which is the actual one, which is actually aggravating the tissue injury that is underlying beneath that. Okay, so the muscles will go for a spasm. As you are describing that the movement restriction is there in both the directions, multiple directions, you always suspect the spasm to be in the picture. Okay. And when spasm is there, obviously, you know that there are a list of techniques you can use, like positional release or reciprocal inhibitions, okay? And see that you can calm the spasm, not just the cold pack or the high frequency tensor, okay? Still, you can see that you can optimize the spasm so that it does not cause or increase the pain perception, okay? You can't tell that because of disc there is no pain, okay? Or disc is the only cause for the pain. Okay, that is why I keep telling that don't see structural. Okay, see multi-structural, see functional. Okay, so always that focus has to be the only way out. Okay, otherwise you will think it's only disc. No. Okay, just because compression test is positive, just because distraction test is negative, you cannot tell it's a disc which is there. Okay. Even ligament associated with the disc can go for a strain, after which the spasm can come. Facet joint capsule can go for a strain, after that spasm can come. Okay. It can go for a sprain if it is sudden movement rotation. Sometimes patient don't remember, okay, so which rotation or any asymmetrical movement they did. But if they're having unilateral symptoms, you should know that it's one of these two. And multiple directions, it is symptomatic. Suspect the spasm. One direction more difficult. One direction is painful. Other direction is restricted. Then you can suspect the facet joint dysfunctions. Okay? Flexion dysfunctions will restrict the extension and flexion will be painful. Extension dysfunctions restrict the flexion and the extension will be painful. Neutral dysfunctions, opposite side lateral bending and the same side rotation. That is the position of dysfunction in L1 to 5. So there what you do is you have a same side lateral flexion which is limited and opposite lateral flexion which is painful. Same side rotation painful, opposite side rotation restricted. Okay, so you have this reverse of the pathomechanics. Okay, that is to be the correction is restricted, where exaggeration of the dysfunction that will be painful. Painful one will always be protected with spasm, and if that spasm is not mechanically provoked, suddenly it is coming, suspect the central sensitization. Okay, the memory pain experience. So those patients might require pain neuroscience education and motor imaging and aerobic exercise prescription. Okay, so these are all mainstay of management in people who have more than 3 months back pain and they are keeping on getting spasms. Okay, they it's never getting treated, again and again it is coming. Okay, you should suspect altered programming. Any stimulus comes, dangerous stimulus, spasm comes. Okay, so you have to think in all the dimensions, right?
And sir, my second question is, today you have demonstrated that auto traction. So when we gave this auto traction for a listhesis patient, like L4, L5 listhesis, L4 over the L5, after giving this auto traction, can we add for the further AMNT, combined AMNT manual therapy?
Predominantly, when you have listhesis, it's a mechanical instability. So to reduce the slipping, you can give traction in a direction which will not aggravate the slip. Okay, the same may not be applicable for retrolisthesis. Okay, but spondylolisthesis you can use this because it is prone position, and prone is there, the slipping vertebrae which is anterior will actually come, the weight of the pelvis pulls the lower vertebrae, okay, with the pelvis. So if this is slipped anterior, pelvis and lower limb is pulling, so it can get corrected. Okay, and flexion position of lumbar spine, always it will reduce the listhesis compared to the extended positions. Okay, this is instability perspective. What you want to use together depend upon the myofascial impairments and the neural impairments. With the listhesis, you have grade 3 and 4 and radiculopathy. Then you will think about lateral instability and then foramen based approaches. Whereas with the listhesis, you have a facet joint syndrome and you have a what is called as a laterally flexed spine. You will progress according to the instability, lateral instability with the facet joint dysfunction based treatments. So you will always be more into focusing on the associated dysfunctions. Myofascial, lower cross syndrome, hyperlordosis, you can have hip flexor tightness and erector spinae being shortening. Okay, so that can be present. So you can use muscle energy techniques for the myofascial tissues also. So there's nothing wrong in that. Okay, to progress into AM and MT, always it is a whether it is athletes means day one, I am telling, but if a sedentary athlete, you cannot use. So it's all guidelines. It does not mean that it is A to Z and that only you have to do. Okay. You have to see that sedentary individual, even if it's an athlete, you have to use after 3 weeks only. Okay, you should be prepared to strategically progress. Okay, not by the disorder, but only by the clinical presentation.
Great, sir, thank you. And sir,
yes, ma'am, continue.
Yes, sir. Sir, if a patient is having a posterior disc bulge, L2, L3, L4, and as well as she is suffering with the knee problem, and the medial compartment space is completely reduced. So, and, as like you have demonstrated today, that SLR technique in the sitting position, the SLR 20.
Not SLR. L2, 3, 4 means prone knee bend. Okay, you have knee flexion and hip extension. Okay, don't think about SLR for L2, 3, 4. Okay, SLR is only for L5 and S1.
Okay, sir. Sir, attraction SLR, that 10 degree, 20 degree.
That cannot be done for L2, 3, 4. It's only for L5, S1. You can recheck the video. If I told L2, 3, 4, I made a mistake.
No, sir. I was just asking ki this technique can we use for knee treatment also, that traction SLR for knee?
We are not seeing here the manual therapy for the knee. Okay, we are seeing the spine. Okay. Understood? You can use any technique for any joints. Okay, depending upon the pathomechanics. But remember that traction to the knee joint, you will not give it in the fully extended position. You will give it in the loose packed position, 20 to 30 degree flexion, basic. Okay. So don't think that there is a compression and I want to treat that. Medial joint space narrowing is nothing for me, because 90% of individuals above 30 years will have medial joint space narrowing. Okay. I am not going to treat the X-ray. I am going to see that what is the presentation in the subject. Okay. Whether first they had knee pain, then they developed back pain. Okay. Then I will think of lower extremity, the kinetic chain influencing the lumbar spine. Okay. Or is it because of hamstring tightness, rectus femoris tightness and trigger points, which overloads the lumbar, making the lumbar spine to be instability because lower limb is stiff. Okay. So either way, I have to see the interrelationship. Okay. So, and I should not deviate away from the topic. The spinal manual therapy is there, means the focus is spine. But at the same time, when you're treating patients, cause can be either spine to the knee or knee to the spine. Okay. Treatment of knee will be indicated only if cause is the knee. Okay. If knee is secondarily involved, as a therapist, you are supposed to treat the knee. But what we are here to discuss is spine.
Okay. Okay. That's it, sir.
And distraction as a mobilization technique. It's not just the traction SLR. See, the term SLR itself, it's not for hip joint traction. Okay. It's not for knee joint traction. It's neural. Okay. Straight leg raise is neural. Sciatic, S1, then L5. That's all. So for that, we are giving the traction, which will relieve the nerve getting adhesion from the other adjacent muscles or foramen being open. But as you asked, without a knee joint distraction or without a hip joint long axis traction or sacroiliac, iliosacral, ilium going inferior, okay? Without that, the ligaments and all should be stretched, then only foramen can open. So this is what is the actual force transmission. But if you see, these are all normal. The pathological one is foramen. We are suspecting that it is foraminal compression and there is radicular and SLR is positive. So then you keep it, then you give this. You have transitions, you progress it. 10 seconds or 30 seconds, you can always hold it and then keep progressing. And when you see that after one traction SLR, which you give 10 degrees before, after that, you recheck the SLR, SLR improves. So that means the mechanosensitivity of the nerve gets calmed as you are mechanically treating the nerve, okay, in combination with the foramen. So the postulates or the principles behind how the techniques are effective was not explained by Brian Mulligan at all. Okay. You don't ask what is the mechanism for snags, what is the mechanism for traction SLR. Okay. Tomorrow I'm going to show bent leg raise technique, BLR. So what is the mechanism of relief by BLR? Okay. Even I was showing this rotations of lumbar spine. Okay. In the crook lying and rotations, it's called as a double leg rotation technique or gate technique, G-A-T-E. Okay. Gate technique named by Brian Mulligan. So why can't it be just rotation, which is helping the annulus fibrosis? This is my pathomechanical understanding. Okay. Why subjects will improve with rotations. But in Mulligan's textbook, nothing is told. You just use the gate technique. It's a very valuable technique for people with low back pain. Okay. Everything is like that. Traction SLR itself, SLR is positive because of hamstring tightness or it is because of neural symptoms. Do that lesser and give the traction. Okay. Mulligan, it's very, very simple and easy. And that's why you might get an immediate recovery, but you may not have long-term recovery. It's good for initial days of treatment. And later you should integrate with muscular motor control and then go for more deeper progression of articular, okay, and neural. Clear?
Right, sir. Thank you,
Dr.
sir.
Dr. Paramita, our other participant, MCMT. Madam is ready to ask her questions after Dr. Ritu.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you hear me?
Yes, absolutely.
Sir, this session was very enlightening, means it's very knowledgeable. So various types of techniques are... Hello?
Yes, yes, please.
Yeah. So my one question was coming in my mind that when I go to the patient who are not actually financially so much what you said viable to buy a biofeedback, so in that case how we can substitute to learn the motor training for those patients?
I think I described that you can do manual assessment, manual treatment, palpation, you can teach them, you can explain that. Still, if the patient cannot understand, you cannot do anything. Understood? We are only having two routes to reach the destination. One is using the feedback, which is either pressure by feedback or auditory feedback or tactile. Patient is not getting both. Patient is not understanding means motor learning is not possible. So motor control retraining is not possible. Okay. So you cannot do anything. Rather, utilize the pressure by feedback, make them to come daily, let them learn under supervision. Okay. It's not that just they have to buy the pressure by feedback. I said that for people who can afford. People who cannot afford, they should come to the therapy. Okay. Nowadays, you see tents is available for 900 rupees. Okay, pocket tents. People can take the tents and they can apply themselves. But if they don't have the affordability to buy the tents, they will pay 300 rupees and they will take the tents one session here, next session tomorrow. After 600, they will feel that I don't have 900 and they will go back. Okay. So it all depends upon the affordability, of course. And there is always alternatives. Physical therapy, we are not dependent on gadgets. But when it comes to motor learning, we need some feedback. And for that, we need accuracy. By palpating, how much ever you tell sternocleidomastoid, relax, 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 subject will not relax. Okay? And you see that rectus abdominis, again, that also overactivation will come. Erectospinae overactivation will come. How will you control that pressure? You cannot keep your palm and say that this much pressure is okay. Or you keep your own palm, the patient feels the weight on the palm and then feel that this is the pressure I should give. No. So they can only memorize with the prior feedback. But if they have good memory, they can learn in the clinic itself. If they have very poor memory, they cannot do anything. If they buy it also, at home also, they cannot utilize and they cannot improve. Okay? It is to do with the cognition. Motor learning is like any other learning. So that way only it will move on. Okay? Financial, that you can purchase in installments. You can purchase second hands. Okay? You can purchase, you can take the treatments in the clinic. A lot of things are there with the economical issues. So that is anyway you can decide as per if you are having a difficulty, what will you do? Okay. So that means why we have multiple options to handle when it is related to money. You can't tell that without spending money, how can we live life? Okay. You have to spend. You may not be able to spend more, so spend less. See where it is less, which one is less, alternative, keep doing. So same way, clinically also, you will utilize. But when you spend money, you are getting a better quality food, better tasty food. When you spend less money, you might get a cheaper quality food, which is not much tasty. Okay. So you know that whatever is the priority, affordability is there, quality will reduce. The rehabilitation success and the outcomes will reduce. Obviously, you cannot be both the things you want. Okay. So if you have to need a better one, that means you have to do better. Okay. So that is how it will come. If they cannot purchase, manual is always there. Okay. All the days I was showing the manual only, palpation and then telling for the motor control training. Okay. Even for individual assessment also, I was telling about manual. Just see the symptom relief, ask them to do. Okay. and the intensity, you are telling 25% or 10%. We don't know whether 10% activation only they are doing. Okay, but still, it's okay. As much as I can feel, it's fine. Because tomorrow also I am going to feel. But if it is one therapist and another therapist, the pressure won't be what I feel in the hand will not be a reliable one for the other therapist. But the same thing, if it is felt on the cuff, definitely it will have a bigger. You can use sphygmomanometer cuff. Okay, the BP apparatus, that cuff is there. So that also you can use the bulb and you can keep the pressure. BP apparatus machine itself. Okay, you can see the pressure. There were some kind of low cost studies. They compared pressure biofeedback with this sphygmomanometer for the motor control retraining. Okay, I was not at all happy with those studies. I read those methodology and it was totally crap. Okay, I don't think it is science. Okay, because you can't see the mercury fluctuation in the sphygmomanometer and tell that any kind of a reading. Okay, whether it is 70 mm, 60 mm, 40 mm, all that things. Okay, it's really very ridiculous. But that study, I think it was in Manipal University. Okay. And the study was published in an Indian journal. So postgraduate got passed out and went. Okay. You can utilize, maybe. Okay. I am not telling that you cannot. Okay. But the quality or the reproducibility or the validity, everything will come down. Okay. So always alternatives will have their own disadvantages. Okay. When we recommend one as the best, definitely you know that the rest of it is not the best. Okay. Yeah.
So in cesarean patient, when we are seeing in obstetrics and gynec, so after the second post-operative day, the we are asked to go to the ward. So there we can, in the first day itself, in the crook lying position, so we can start the rectus the transverse abdominis muscle, the multifidus training with the biofeedback.
Why do you think you cannot start? Why do you have the doubt that you cannot start? For anybody, it is not a contraindication. Okay? As long as brain is working for the patient, you can do it. Unconscious patient, you cannot. Okay?
Yeah.
Otherwise, it's not at all contraindicating. Because you know when the symptom is becoming worse, you are a therapist who can communicate with the subject. Subject can report that. And you know, crook lying in the same position, crook lying or supine or even prone. I was telling that you can use this cuff in sitting and standing. After FNST, you will think that in any position you can use this cuff. Okay. So there is absolutely, there's nothing. You can always use. What makes you to think you cannot use? Okay. And incision does not mean that you should not activate the muscle, because static abdominal is different from transverse abdominis. Okay. Static abdominal is for the rectus abdominis. Transverse abdominis is 10% activation. Okay. Static abdominals, it will be 80-70% contraction and it is for strengthening. Okay. That is outdated. Transverse abdominis is endurance. It's more for stability. It's very, very easy. 10%, it will never open the stitch. Nothing will happen. Okay. You don't keep a stigma that 1 week it is not over. Stitches are not yet removed. So can I do or not? Okay. 1 week, if you don't do the exercises, more wasting, more difficult to get it back. Okay. And if you want to convince the surgeon, then you think of that interprofessional strategies, how well you can incorporate. Okay. And see that patient should not be afraid of doing the pressure point feedback. If the patient tells, now only operated, just 2 days, I don't want to do. Nothing you do. Don't explain. Okay? Because nothing will happen. You are thinking that you are going to help. Never. After that, the lady will, chit-chat with other women who have got the babies and walking around here and there somewhere and got more pain in the incision. Or didn't take bath, so infection, suture site. Okay? Or the nurse did not maintain the cleanliness when they were maintaining the wound, for example, and got the infection. First thing that the lady will tell is, I told that physiotherapist that I will not do the exercises. That madam kept that cuff and told me to do this. That is why this has got infected. Understood? So consent is always very, very important. Patient should feel that confident. Surgeon also should provide that cooperation. Okay. When this is there, definitely you can do anything at any time. Okay. When it comes to stability training, what contraindicates? Nothing. Okay. Even burns. In the presence of burns, if you do, what is going to happen? Nothing will happen. Okay. 10% contraction is not going to create anything. When the subject can turn around in the bed, subject can come to sitting from the supine. Okay. Side lying and then coming. Core muscles will be active anyway. Breathing anyway they are doing. Pelvic floor anyway they have to do. Blood, 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 blood and bubble. Nothing is new. Why you are thinking that core stability means athletic core stability, Pilates core stability, Tai Chi core stability? No. Okay. That is the pathetic way of misconception about core stability that people are training like that, grass methods. But remember, if you are concentrating on motor control training and you are seeing for low load, multiple repetitions and gradual progressions, individual activation, co-contraction, then static to dynamic stability, then transitions and transfers, I don't think anything will create any worsening. Okay. But if the load is not maintained, over-motivated patient, they want to do too much of contraction and they utilize substitution and they activate the rectus abdominis or the external internal obliques, okay, the suture site might open up. Okay. So you do not actually can't predict, okay, what can happen during the contraction. First five contractions may be correct. Sixth or seventh may be the altered contraction where subject might do sit-ups, okay, or curl-ups, okay, in the crook line, similar to that contraction. You really can't say that it is patient's mistake. Okay. Surgeon will come and ask that, why did you give this pressure by feedback on the second day? Okay. Why stitch is unnecessarily open and it is hernia. So later we have to do the resurgery, unnecessarily all this thing. Rather, 8th day, 10th day, 3 weeks, soft tissue healing has happened. Whatever substitution is happening, still injury will not worsen. Okay. So then consent and permissions, no problem. Do it. No problem. Either way, if it is a responsible patient who can tell that no problem, I will do. And whenever it is a little bit difficult, I will take rest. I'll do 4 times, tired, take rest. Some days evening, once only I will do. I might be tired. I may not be able to breathe. Then I will not do. So that learning effect is there, patient can do. Okay. But sometimes they get like, if I do more means I will become faster or my tummy will become small. Okay. And I will look like a young girl again. Okay. So better I will do this again. So keep the pressure by feedback and keep on doing nothing. That is actually again surgery only within a week. Okay. So that's something, it's to make the personality type. Okay. The cognitive level of the person. Okay. And the extent of communication. Okay. The surgeon, therapist and the patient. Okay. Otherwise tissue level, if you see, say first, wait for 3 weeks. Till then, manually only you teach. Okay. It's absolutely fine. It is like static abdominal only. And use the pressure by feedback after the 3 weeks.
Thank you, sir.
So think of, there are barriers to everything. There are, multiple factors interacting and we never know what can come in the picture, okay, in reality. Okay. So we are just telling some kind of branches. This happened. That is the thing. You will think that when I am telling that, this happened. This is the second day I will not. Okay. So you're getting convinced. But this is your route. But another patient who is really cooperative, definitely they might tell if it's an actress, okay, who's actually been very active, yoga, okay, like for example, Anushka, okay. She got a child and after that, you want to do the pressure by feedback, even if it's a cesarean, you want to do it. If she tells that, no, I have been very active, so I will do it, I'll start it. No problem. Surgeon also will tell that, okay, you do. Okay. because she'll tell that I don't want to lose my appearance. Okay, again I have to be for the advertisements, I have to be the model. Okay, so all this, so the personal motivation is different. Okay, it impacts a large way in the recovery. Okay, patient who is afraid, nocebo. Patients who are positively reinforced and they are self confident, placebo. So they will improve faster. Do we have any more queries? Do we have Dr. Udem, Dr. Paramita and Dr. Ritu, who joined us for the interactive question and answer session for day 5 CSMT? Day 6 we are going to see the final phase, the myofascial low back pain and also the miscellaneous low back pain including coccydynia, and we're going to wind up the first full certification course of the AOMPT post lockdown, post COVID, the new normal, and the course that is first launched at the newly established Center for Manual Therapy Education and Training at Bangalore. So it's a big achievement for tomorrow. I really expect that every enrolled participant should be present live, okay, and join the collective achievement. Okay, so I appreciate the presence of Dr. Ritu and Dr. Paramita, or MCMT, OCOMT. They are also CSMTs, so going to be CNMT. Okay, so nice to have you both. Wish you good luck. Stay blessed. Keep thinking more. The more you think, the less you do. Okay, it's like experts. Your reasoning should be big. Okay, technique should be very specific, and recovery automatically it will happen extraordinary, exceptionally. Okay, so make sure that all these thought processes only make the approach better. Okay, which technique we can use and how we can individualize. Each patient experience will come to a spectrum where how to modify for such patient, how to modify for this patient. Okay? It cannot come as part of the instruction. Okay, when I am telling that if a patient is like this, means you do that. Okay? Biopsychosocial. I can only talk of biological. Okay, and when you are asking questions, it comes, the psychosocial aspects always will come. Okay, clear. So we are ready to close the session for today. And we have that 1 hour webinar, 1 hour means 40 minutes. Okay, I might come on Facebook for the unilateral symptom symptomatology. Okay, and the clinical pattern progression. Okay, unilateral, right? For the clinical pattern recognition. Okay, that's for the facet joint and the radiculopathy, stenosis, lateral stenosis, lateral instability, all of them as a clinical disorder. Okay, so I would come on the Facebook at maybe around 7 to 8. Okay, so today we'll see 6:30 or 7:30 maybe maximum. So that will conclude this day. Then we come back tomorrow. Tomorrow's myofascial and the miscellaneous clinical pattern recognitions already I have covered. So I won't be taking any webinar for that clinical progression, okay, or the pattern recognitions, right? So get back through with the videos. Today's videos also you watch more, you will get a better spectrum. I have not covered the myofascial intentionally because tomorrow myofascial low back pain is there. And of course, miscellaneous, the treatment considerations, right? So see you both. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Good luck.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Ritu also started taking screenshots.